So we are astonishingly good in generating evidence in medicine and public health. But sometimes that evidence is incomplete, sometimes it's conflicting, sometimes it's ambiguous. And whether that evidence shapes the way we prevent or treat disease falls to regulators, policymakers, and their expert advisors. And that's what my research looks at. I look at the ways in which evidence is translated into policy, particularly around medical interventions like pharmaceuticals, screening technologies, and most especially vaccination here in the United States and around the world. So right now I'm spending a lot of time thinking about cost-effectiveness analyses. These are the use of economic tools to help us understand the ways in which we set priorities in public health and medicine. Cost-effectiveness analyses are seen as a very valuable tool to show the benefits that can come for the expenses a certain policy option requires, including in vaccines, but they're not without criticisms. They're not without critics who argue that they fail to account for the full range of benefits of one option versus another, that they may not fully represent how much we as a society think about preventing life-saving, life-threatening illness or preventing illness in children. So they're fraught in terms of whether this tool should drive the way in which policymakers set priorities in terms of what we spend our limited resources on, or whether they can be part of a larger conversation. So vaccines against measles have been around for over 50 years, and they have been remarkably successful in all but eliminating measles in the United States and in other countries. But cases remain, outbreaks occur, and those outbreaks are centered among those small number of parents who choose not to vaccinate their children, whether for religious reasons or reasons related to their philosophical or personal beliefs. And state policymakers have been working very hard to figure out the right set of policy solutions to encourage and in some cases require parents to vaccinate their children even when their own preferences might speak otherwise. We hear about school entry requirements, we hear about financial incentives, and it's critically important to figure out the right mix to both resolve parents' concerns but also to ensure that their children are protected. So often in medicine we're thinking about trying to eliminate unnecessary or excessive care. But for meningitis vaccines, we know we have tools that work very well. But these tools would cost billions of dollars if we were to use them to prevent a very small number, maybe a dozen or two cases of bacterial meningitis, particularly a type of meningitis called meningococcal subgroup B. So to use these vaccines, the questions are, how can we do the most good? Should we try and spend every dollar we can to prevent a handful of cases? Or should we use those dollars to invest in the other tools, vaccines, prevention, medicine, elsewhere, to prevent the greatest number of cases? So it's the question about the role of public health policymakers in thinking about the individual, and also thinking about the greater good at the community level.